Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to the 30th meeting of the Justice Committee in 2015? Ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices. No apologies have been received, and I welcome Patricia Ferguson, who's with us for item two. Decision one, take business in private. Can I ask you if you'll consider item four, draft stage one report of the Queen to Justice Scotland Bill, and item five, our work programme in private? Thank you very much. Item two, inquiries into fatal accidents and sudden death Scotland Act. We move to stage two proceedings on this. Remind members our aim is to complete stage two today. Members should have their copies of the bill, the marshalled list, groupings of amendments for today's consideration. I welcome Paul Wheelhouse, Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs, and his officials. And I'm moving straight on to the stage two. I call amendment one in the name of Margaret Mitchell, grouped with amendments The question is that section one be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Now, no, you didn't notice that, did you, team? No. You'd have let that go by. And that's a whole big bit. Call amendment one in the name of Margaret Mitchell, group with amendments 56, 2, 2A, 57, 3, 4, 5, 5A, 6, 58 and 7. Margaret, please, to move amendment one and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. During the consideration of stage one, the committee came to the conclusion that there was no need for a mandatory FAI because some deaths of those detained under mental health legislation were straightforward. This decision was influenced by the Mental Welfare Commission's comments about the number of deaths detained patients being as a result of natural causes. However, in preparation for the Stage 1 debate, I revisited Lord Cullen's review and note that he states, even investigations into deaths by natural causes may reveal unsafe conditions. It is in the public interest that an FAI should be held into the deaths of those detained by the state, especially those who are the most vulnerable. I am therefore not convinced that the monitoring and investigation of cases by the Mental Welfare Commission is in itself an adequate safeguard for protecting some of the most vulnerable people in society. This is particularly the case if these individuals have no family members to advocate for them. And it is this scenario which has prompted Amendment 2, which provides for mandatory FAIs for deaths A, in mental health detention, or B, on receiving treatment on a voluntary basis, but with an opt-out provision. Both the Mental Welfare Commission and the Royal College of Psychiatrists expressed concern that the mandatory FAIs for the approximately 73 deaths a year of patients detained under mental health legislation would vastly increase the number of FAIs. However, this fails to take account of the effect of Amendment 5 in my name, which puts in place an opt-out provision for the Lord Advocate, provided he gives reasons to satisfy why he considers no FAI necessary. As the authorities are confident at present, the vast majority of these deaths are easily explained. This should not be an onerous provision. Crucially, however, the opt-out and the compulsory explanation required will ensure, where patients have no family members to advocate on their behalf, that the conditions and circumstances of the death of those individuals detained by the state are properly scrutinised. Hence, this ensures complete accountability and transparency regarding these deaths. Furthermore, in England and Wales, all deaths under compulsory and mental health detention are subject to an inquest by the coroner unless it has been ascertained that the death was from natural causes. To put the necessity for these amendments in perspective, in 2013-14, the number of deaths in formal detention in Scotland under mental health legislation was 60. In informal, voluntary admission, it was six times as many, 364. Given this, my amendment not only provides important safeguards, but also ensures compliance with Article 2 of the European Convention of Human Rights, the right to life. The state has a general duty to protect life, and it is therefore only right that the deaths of those detained by the state are thoroughly scrutinised. However, I have taken on board the comments about the number of cases this may involve, and although this is not a reason in itself to exclude the deaths of individuals who have voluntarily received treatment for a mental disorder, I do consider the amendments in the name of Alison McInnes, which complement the amendments in my name, strike the right balance at this time. I therefore move Amendment 1 in my name.
Alison McInnes, please to speak to Amendment 56 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, and I welcome this chance to speak on these amendments in Section 2 of the Bill. This section sets out the circumstances under which mandatory public inquiries into certain deaths are to be held, and the Bill, as it currently stands, fails to include a number of Lord Cullen's recommendations, as Margaret Mitchell has said. I believe that when the state has the responsibility for the health, safety and ultimately the life of someone, there should be an inquiry into what went wrong should they die. We are talking about those in society who are the most vulnerable, such as older people and patients with mental health problems. The Scottish Human Rights Commission has said that steps need to be taken to ensure that the systems of investigation meet the Article 2 requirements outlined above and to remedy what's currently a lot of gaps and confusion in the system. I know that Richard Simpson did some sterling work on the Mental Health Bill, and I note that a review into how deaths of those detained under mental health legislation will take place, but I also understand that the timescale for that is up to three years. That's good to have the review, but I think we need to deal with this issue in the interim, and I will therefore support Margaret Mitchell's amendments. Ms Mitchell's Amendment 2 is the main amendment in her group, and I'm concerned that it goes too far by including mental health patients who have been admitted to hospital voluntarily, and my Amendment 2A removes that requirement. My Amendment 5A removes the Lord Advocate's discretion to not hold an FEI if the patient who has been detained was receiving compulsory treatment. Similarly, my Amendment 57 introduces a requirement to hold a mandatory FEI for patients with dementia who immediately before their death received prolonged treatment using psychotropic medication. This type of medication causes sedation, confusion and movement difficulty. Overuse of these drugs in this situation has been implicated in the increase of the chance of a stroke. A number of organisations, including the Mental Welfare Commission, have raised concerns about the widespread use of these drugs in a care home setting. And again, in this case, the most vulnerable people in our society deserve our attention. There have been a number of high-profile cases where family have raised concerns about the circumstances of what appear to be deaths by natural causes. It should be the responsibility of the state to investigate and learn from any mistakes made in an open and transparent way. My amendments 56 and 58 are consequential amendments.
Thank you. Any other members? Roddy, please.
Thank you, Convener. I've listened carefully to what both of the members have said. First point, Margaret Mitchell's referred to Lord Cullen's report, but I think it's fair to point out that Lord Cullen's report didn't deal with the question of voluntary admissions. Alison McInnes does accept that by proposing to delete that bit from Margaret Mitchell's amendment. It's also, I think we should remember that at the present time, there is a discretion to hold a fatal accident inquiry in any event if there were concerns on the part of the Lord Advocate. So it's not quite a black and white situation. And reference has also been made to Section 37 of the Mental Health Act, which has recently been passed, which imposes a duty on the government to review the arrangements for investigating the deaths of patients. Obviously, the timescale for that is within 3 years. It would perhaps be helpful if the government could expedite that, but I don't think that this bill at this time is the appropriate time to review and change the current position. And finally, in relation to the question of deaths where patients have been treated with psychotropic drugs, I am very sympathetic to the issue here. I think there is an issue about the usage of psychotropic drugs and whether the guidelines, which are now 9 years older, are still appropriate. But again, I think that's a wider issue and not something which I think we should seek to encapsulate in the debate on these amendments.
This issue for me is about relationships. It is the relationship between the state and the individual. It's also about the perception. And I think any member of the public listening in would find Margaret and Alison's comments both very measured, and I certainly will be lending my support to that.
Christian?
Yes, thank you. One point about I had talked about was the situation of the Lord Advocate. I think Mr. Campbell is absolutely right. There is a possibility with discretion for the Lord Advocate to have an inquiry. But more to the point, regarding the families of the deceased, you know, whatever there are families and no families, I don't think the Lord Advocate will make any kind of judgment to hold an inquiry or not an inquiry. Resisting pressure from families or not. I think a Lord Advocate will decide to have an inquiry, whatever there is a family around the victim or not.
Elaine. Yeah, thank you, Convener. Yeah, I have a lot of sympathy for these amendments too, and I would say really in answer to what Roddy Campbell was saying, having the discretion to have an FAI and not using it is not the same as being required to have one and being able to opt out, because actually if the Lord Advocate decides not to hold an FAI, there will be some sort of explanation. And I think given the vulnerability of the people we're discussing at the moment, particularly those people who are compulsorily detained, I think actually to have that sort of reassurance in terms of the inquiry is not being held, but to know why it's not being held, is that would actually be welcome. With regard to Alison's amendments on people who have been treated by psychotropic drugs, I think it's an important issue. I'm not sure whether it needs to be in the bill, but I certainly think some sort of reassurance that is being looked at in a very serious way. If the minister is able to give us that sort of assurance, that would be helpful.
I have to say I'm very sympathetic to the arguments. However, I take a fairly plain view of things, that something's either mandatory or it's not mandatory. And there are, as has been explained, discretions on whether or not one holds inquiries in certain circumstances. But what sustains me in keeping this position is Section 8, under reasons for decision not to hold an inquiry, where I think we made progress, where family members did not need to request it. It would be issued in any event. And I think we have quite a lot of people policing the Lord Advocate now. If there was a decision not to hold an FAI in any of the circumstances described by my colleagues here, and not only would have the Mental Welfare Commission or the Care Commission, but we'd have the press. You know, there are pressures on the Crown Office, quite rightly now, and it's also embedded in this Act. So while I accept the arguments that put forward, I come back to think it's mandatory or it's not mandatory, and where it's a discretion and one feels that discretion has not been exercised properly, then the Crown Office must give reasons for that, and again, that would be subject to a wide range of scrutiny. So I'm satisfied as long as we find Section 8 is amended in the way that we had asked. Cabinet Secretary, Minister, I'm promoting you.
Thank you, Convener. The group includes amendments in the name of Margaret Mitchell which would require mandatory FAIs into the desks of patients in hospitals receiving mental health treatment on a compulsory or voluntary basis, as we've just heard. Mental health patients who die whilst receiving treatment in hospital for something such as a heart attack or cancer, which is unrelated to their mental health condition, would be affected by this proposal. And it is difficult to see how the public interest is served by holding an FAI in such circumstances. Currently, the Mental Welfare Commission is automatically informed of any deaths of detained patients and has a discretionary power to carry out its own independent investigation and inquiry. The Commission already liaises with the Crown Office in cases which they feel may merit an FAI. Therefore, if there was any suspicion or suggestion that a death was the result of the inadequate or inappropriate treatment, then that death would already be investigated by the Mental Welfare Commission and or by the Crown Office. The Crown Office is also updating its guidance to medical practitioners to ensure that any or all deaths while subject to compulsory treatment under mental health legislation are reported to the Procurator Fiscal and would therefore be investigated as appropriate in common with all other sudden, suspicious or unexplained deaths, of which it should be noted that only 50 to 60 finally result in an FAI. I think it's highly significant that neither the Mental Welfare Commission nor the Royal College of Psychiatrists support having mandatory FAIs for detained mental health patients. They believe, and we agree, that such a provision would be disproportionate and, as I've said before, potentially lead to unnecessary distress for the family of any deceased person. In response to this amendment, the Royal College of Psychiatrists have said, and I quote, convener, it is stigmatising to suggest mental health care and treatment should be subject to special scrutiny in relation to patient deaths, bearing in mind the commonality of mental health problems and physical illness prevalence. We would oppose any amendments seeking to change this at stage two, and we urge the committee to reject any such amendments, end quote. The committee will be aware of new provision at section 37 of the Mental Health Scotland Act 2015, which has been referred to, which requires that ministers carry out a review within 3 years of the arrangements for investigating the deaths of patients who at the time of the death were detained under either the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003 or the Criminal Procedures Scotland Act 1995, or alternatively, who were admitted voluntarily for treatment for mental disorders. The Mental Welfare Commission, again quote, believes that this review is an important opportunity to create a system of investigation of deaths of psychiatric patients which is proportionate, streamlined and effective. And, again I quote, believe the priority should be for the review to be established and for its work to begin. I wish to reassure members of the committee and indeed other members present that the review of the arrangements for the investigation of deaths of mental health patients will commence as soon as is possible, and in fact initial discussions are already taking place with stakeholders. The Scottish Government will consider with stakeholders the scope of the review, and in doing so will consider whether it's possible to ensure that there are safeguards to protect against any alleged deaths of patients as a result of covert treatment or compulsory electroconvulsive therapy or other treatment, which I know is of concern to Alison MacInnes. I do not believe that it would be appropriate or sensible to legislate to extend the mandatory category in relation to deaths of mental health patients in advance of the work of that review, arising from, of course, Section 37 of the Mental Health Scotland Act 2015. Amendment 5, in the name of Margaret Mitchell, provides discretion for the Lord Advocate to not hold a mandatory FEI where there has been an investigation or inquiry by the Mental Welfare Commission. Such investigations by the Commission are, however, only carried out by the Commission where there has been apparent ill treatment, neglect or deficiency in care. The amendment as drafted would therefore have the effect to require FEIs to be held in cases of natural cause or expected deaths. Amendment 7, in the name of Margaret Mitchell, would amend Section 8 of the Bill, which places a duty on the Lord Advocate to provide written reasons where it is decided that an FEI is not to be held when requested to do so by the nearest relative. As the convener has indicated, this amendment requires the Lord Advocate to give written reasons in all cases when it has been decided that there will be no FEI for a death of a patient in hospital receiving mental health treatment. In these cases, written reasons would have to be given, crucially, without a request, even having been made by the nearest relative, again, as the convener has indicated. For all other types of cases, a request needs to be made before the Lord Advocate's duty takes effect. There is simply no good reason to make the rule different for mental health cases and all other cases. What is important is that the Crown Office maintains a level of contact with the bereaved family that they have indicated they want, and we believe there are better ways of achieving this than through the amendment. Indeed, the need for tailored support and guidance for individual family circumstances is exactly the sort of thing that will be provided for in the Crown Office's proposed family liaison charter, and I agree with the committee's observation in its stage one report on Patricia Ferguson's inquiries into deaths bill that if the scope of mandatory FEIs is extended to include the deaths of those detained under mental health legislation, the number of inquiries will rise significantly and therefore the financial impact would be significant. It will of course be even more significant if voluntary patients are also included. Whilst I take the point that Alison MacInnes' Amendment 2A would remove voluntary patients from Amendment 2, the Scottish Government still cannot support mandatory FEIs into mental health-related detention or compulsory treatment. Based on data from the Scottish Government and Mental Welfare Commission, each year there are approximately 78 deaths of patients subject to detention or compulsory mental health treatment. If mandatory FEIs were to be held into all of these deaths, this would, at a stroke, more than double the number of FEIs in Scotland per annum. At least 39 of these died from natural causes where the death was expected, but their deaths would have triggered mandatory FEIs under these proposed arrangements. I note that there were 424 deaths of psychiatric inpatients in 2013-14, which includes voluntary patients. This amendment could therefore potentially increase the number of FEIs sevenfold. I think it's hugely important to consider that these proposals may not be welcomed by bereaved families of mental health patients themselves, who may not wish to have the death of a loved one in psychiatric care become the focus of a fatal accident inquiry held in public. We have similar concerns with regard to the amendments in the name of Alison McInnes, which would, as drafted, require a mandatory FEI into the death of any patient suffering from dementia who is receiving treatment in a hospital or care home service and being treated with psychotropic drugs for the 3 months leading up to their deaths. As stated in the recent letter from the Mental Welfare Commission, patients suffering from dementia often die whilst receiving treatment in hospital for something such as a heart attack or cancer, which is unrelated to their mental health condition, including dementia. I do note the point that Alison McInnes made about strokes, though, that I take that on board. And hopefully the review will be able to look at that particular issue. But similarly to Margaret Mitchell's amendments, these natural cause deaths would be affected by this proposal. And in my opinion, it is difficult to see how the public interest would be served by holding an FEI in such circumstances. These amendments, in effect, imply that using psychotropic medication with people with dementia is a bad thing and requires extra scrutiny. I do take the point, though, that Alison McInnes has made. It is my understanding that patients with dementia often experience aggression, agitation, loss of inhibitions, delusions and hallucinations, which can, regrettably, have to require psychotropic medication. And I further understand that clinical guidelines and safeguards are in place on the appropriate use of antipsychotics to help manage these distressing symptoms. The committee will be possibly aware of an upcoming review of treatment of learning disability, autism spectrum disorder and dementia within the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003. Scottish ministers committed to this review during the passage of the Mental Health Scotland Act 2015, and the Mental Welfare Commission will be consulting with key stakeholders in early 2016 to begin to scope the content and detail of the review. In view of that review and the statutory review of the arrangements for investigating the deaths of mental health patients under Section 37 of the 2015 Act, I firmly believe it would be premature and inappropriate to legislate to extend the mandatory category in relation to deaths of dementia patients in advance of the review's work and recommendations. Amendment 5A, in the name of Alison McInnes, amends Amendment 5 by ensuring that deaths of mental health patients subject to compulsory treatment under Part 7 of the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003 would not be an exception under Section 3, therefore meaning that a mandatory FEI would be required in every such case. We do not have exact figures for the number of deaths that could be captured by this amendment. However, we have been assured that the impact would be so fundamental that it would overload the system of fatal accident inquiries, as well as leading to unnecessary distress for families and indeed potentially staff. Whilst we understand and very much sympathise, as committee members do, with the members' concerns regarding this group of vulnerable people, for the reasons I have set out and that have also been set out by both the Mental Welfare Commission and the Royal College of Psychiatrists, the Scottish Government does not support these amendments and instead believes that having discretionary FEIs for such cases strikes the right balance. For all of these reasons, I would ask the members not to press their amendments.
Oh, it's really for Margaret to wind up, but I don't know if Alison, if you want to respond to any. I thought I'd give it, you a writing there, so I thought you might want to respond a little bit.
I'm grateful for the opportunity okay. to do so. And I'm also grateful to the Minister for the assurances that he's put on the record today, particularly in relation to my Amendment 57, round about the concerns that even Roddy Campbell acknowledged were live issues at the moment. And I'm grateful that the review might well be is already in the process of being commissioned. And on that basis, I certainly don't need to say anything at the moment. Okay. Okay. Thank
Hold
you.
Us in suspense there. Margaret, please, it's for you to wind up and press her withdrawal.
Right. Thank you, Convener. If I could address the stigma issue that the Minister has brought up, that somehow having a mandatory FOI for those detained mental health patients detained. Could I perhaps refer him to the comments from Enable Scotland? We think that the deaths of people detained under the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003 should be included in the mandatory category. Those individuals who have been deprived of their liberty should have the same protection as those detained in prison or pre-cell. So I think that quite conclusively explains there is no stigma. There is very definitely a fairness issue here and a justice issue. And in terms of the convener's comment, it's either mandatory or it isn't. I think what that fails to take account of is the fact that, yes, it's mandatory with an opt-out, and the change of emphasis is giving this added protection to this very vulnerable group of individuals, and also, I would argue, ensuring compliance with Section 2 of the European Convention of Human Rights, the right to life. The Minister has made much, and again I've taken on board his comments and the Royal College of Psychiatrists' concerns about the number of cases which could be added to the FAI workload if my amendment were to be passed. But it's for this very reason I provided an opt-out to a mandatory FAI for the Lord Advocate if the Lord Advocate considers this is not necessary, and importantly, if he also states his reasons for that. That's important for transparency and accountability. And if it's natural causes and the death is so obvious, it isn't going to be onerous on him to give these reasons, and it isn't going to add substantially to the number of deaths in that category at present. I know the review of the arrangements already been talked about by Alison and the Minister for investigating the deaths of patients receiving treatment for a mental disorder. And while the timetable seems to be moved forward, this is still, I think, within 3 years of the provision of the 2015 Mental Health Scotland Act coming into force. However, I also note that there were 424 deaths last year of such patients, of which 60 were in the compulsory detention category, and a concerning 364 were voluntary admissions. So this is certainly an issue to be revisited in the future. In the meantime, I urge committee members to support my amendments, which I consider in conjunction with the amendments lodged by Alison McInnes, do provide the right balance and protection for those mental health patients who are, by any standards, a very vulnerable group of people. I press Amendment 1 in my name.
The question is, Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. That amendment is agreed to. I call Amendment 52 in the name of Alison McInnes, group with Amendments 53 and 54. Alison, please, to move Amendment 52 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Thank you very much for that. This group amendment yet again refers to Section 2 of the Bill, of course. My Amendment 53 is the main amendment in this group. It introduces the requirement to hold a mandatory FAI as a result of a death of a child who is looked after by the state, even if they lived with their parents or guardians at the time of their death. When social services are involved, there's usually a good reason for it, and it becomes our responsibility to keep these children safe. While acknowledging there's a limit to what a social worker can do, we also need to recognise that lessons need to be learned should any mistakes be found to have been made in these tragic situations. We're not talking of a great many cases as described in my amendment, but I hope we can all agree that even one child who has died while being looked after by the state is too many. It's important we have a mechanism in place that would require any such cases being considered in an open and transparent way as offered by an FAI. And together, the Scottish Alliance for Children's Rights, in their written submission to the committee, did indeed argue for this position, and they said in their submission, the proposal for FAIs for children in secure accommodation is welcomed but should be widened to include all looked after children. The Scottish Government has a direct responsibility for all looked after children, regardless of whether they are in secure care, residential care or foster care, and as such any death of a looked after child must be investigated regardless of placement type. And I move my amendment.
Thank you very much. Anyone else wishing to speak? Roddy?
I listened to what Alison said, but I think obviously you need to bear in mind that there are current regulations, the Looked After Children Scotland Regulations 2009, which provide that any deaths are required local authorities to report to Scottish ministers and indeed the Care Inspectorate within 1 day. So one assumes that if the Care Inspectorate actually have that report, that they will carry out an inquiry. If they're concerned, they will in turn kind of report to the Crown Office, and we could at that point then have a discretionary inquiry launched by the Crown Office. So I think we should bear that in mind in considering that. And also, we didn't actually, I think, take much in the way of oral evidence on this point. There were some written submissions, and I noticed in a recent letter to the committee, the Centre for Excellence for Looked After Children argue, I think, reasonably strongly against the idea of having mandatory inquiries. So there's by no means uniform view amongst the professionals in that area.
Minister?
Thank you, Convener. This group of amendments in the name of Alison McInnes would require mandatory FEIs into the deaths of children looked after by a local authority. This provision would affect every natural cause and expected death of looked after children, many of which are as a result of life-limiting conditions, and it is difficult to see how the public interest, including the families, would be served by holding an FEI in such circumstances. These amendments fail to recognise that a judicially led inquiry is not the only means of investigating the deaths of children in the care of the state. As confirmed by Glasgow City Council during Stage 1 evidence, the deaths of looked after children are already provided for through the reporting requirements of the Looked After Children Scotland Regulations 2009, which require local authorities to notify the Scottish Ministers and the Care Inspectorate of a death within one working day. This reporting responsibility had been further extended by the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014 to include the reporting of deaths of any care leaver up to the age of 26 and any young person in a continuing care placement. Deaths of children in residential establishments, half of which are as a result of life-limiting conditions and other health issues, are investigated and reviewed by the Care Inspectorate. The Care Inspectorate identifies any lessons to be learned and makes recommendations for the review of legislation, policy or guidance. Such deaths are already the subject, therefore, of investigation by the Procurator Fiscal, and the Lord Advocate has discretionary power to hold an FEI into such deaths when it is considered to be in the public interest. The Crown Office liaises with the Care Inspectorate and refers to its reports to inform decisions on whether to hold a discretionary FEI. The committee will also be aware of the Child Death Review. Ministers agreed Scotland should set up a national child death review system to review the deaths of all children and young people, not just those in care. A steering group met between January and June this year to develop a model for the system. Its report and recommendations will be submitted to ministers very shortly. I do not believe that it would be appropriate or sensible to legislate to extend the mandatory category in relation to deaths of looked after children in advance of the work of that review. The Care Inspectorate reported that there were 30 deaths of looked after children in Scotland in the three-year period 2009 to 2011. This could mean an additional 10 EFIs per year as a result of this provision. However, the resource impact is of course not only the only consideration. Both Glasgow City Council and the Centre for Excellence for Looked After Children in Scotland during Stage 1 evidence did not support extending the mandatory category in this way. Glasgow City Council considers the current arrangements for the reporting and review of deaths of looked after children that I just described to be suitable and sufficient. The Centre for Excellence for Looked After Children did not recommend making this a mandatory category because it said there was no certainty it would lead to improvements in services for looked after children and those leaving care. In its letter of the 19th of October to the committee, it reiterated its view that it was not necessary to extend the provision for mandatory FEIs to all accidental or sudden deaths of looked after children in residential care. On the basis of the points I've set out above, and the Scottish Government does not support these amendments and agrees that the provisions in the Looked After Children Regulations, Children and Young People Act 2014, combined with having discretionary FEIs for such cases, strikes the right balance. These proposals would, we believe, not be welcomed by bereaved families of looked after children. Some looked after children continue to live in the family home following involvement with the children's hearing system. 11 of the deaths in 2009 to 2011 were of children living at home or with relatives. Others live away from their family homes, such as with a foster carer or in residential accommodation. 12 of the deaths reported were in residential care and 4 were in foster care. Children usually become looked after to promote their care, such as respite care for children with complex difficulties or disabilities, and to protect them, for example, from neglect or abuse. Families of those and those known to the child may not wish to have the death become the focus of a public inquiry. I would also remind the committee that under the bill, as it stands, the death of a child in secure accommodation would trigger a mandatory FEI. For all of these reasons, I would ask the member to withdraw her amendments.
Alison, to wind up, press her withdrawal, please.
Thank you, Convener. Well, I would caution the Minister on making cases about the resource impact. I think that's the weakest argument, really, about it. If there are a number of cases that need to be investigated, then they need to be investigated.
And I just say I agree with you about
that. I don't like to hear resources coming in because it should be in principle. So.
But that aside, I think the Minister has set out a detailed reason as to why not. I considered this group of amendments, 52, 53 and 54, to be probing amendments to test where the government is on all of this. I'm grateful to hear of more about the review and on that, you know, under those circumstances, I will not press Amendment 52.
Thank you very much. The question... Oops. Call Amendment 50. I beg your pardon? She's not pressing it. She's not. Oh, you've moved it. I beg your pardon. So you've got to leave to withdraw.
Okay, leave to withdraw.
I think they're going to let you do it.
Okay.
So, thank you very much. Call Amendment 56 in the name of Alison McInnes. Ready with Amendment 1. Move or not move?
Not move. That's consequential. 57.
Thank you very much. Call Amendment 2 in the name of Margaret Mitchell. Ready with Amendment 1. Move or not move? I call Amendment 2A in the name of Alison McInnes. Already debated with Amendment 1. Alison, move or not move?
Move.
The question is, Amendment 2A be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. 5-4, 4 against. That amendment is agreed. The question is, Amendment 2 is amended be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
There's not an agreement. Therefore, there will be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. It's 5 in favour, 4 against. That amendment is agreed to. Call Amendment 53 in the name of Alice McInnes. Already debated with Amendment 52. Move or not move?
Moved.
Call Amendment 57 in the name of Alice McInnes. Already debated with Amendment 1. Move or not move?
Not moved.
Call Amendment 3 in the name of Margaret Mitchell. Already debated with Amendment 1. Move or not move?
Moved.
The question is, Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please show. Excuse me. Those against, please show. 5 in favour, 4 against. That amendment is agreed to. Question is that section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Please.
Call Amendment 4 in the name of Margaret Mitchell. Ready debated with Amendment 1. Move or not move?
Moved.
Question is Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Not agreed, there will be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. 5 in favour, 4 against. That amendment is agreed to. Call Amendment 5 in the name of Margaret Mitchell. Ready debated Amendment 1. Move or not move?
Moved.
Call Amendment 5A in the name of Alice McInnes. Already debated with Amendment 1. Move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. The question is Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. It's 5-4, 4 against. That amendment is agreed to. The question is that Section 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Call Amendment 6 in the name of Margaret Mitchell. Already debated with Amendment 1. Move or not move?
Moved.
The question is Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. 5 in favour, 4 against. That amendment is agreed to. Call Amendment 54 in the name of Alison McInnes. Ready to debate with Amendment 52. Alison, move or not move?
Not moved.
Call Amendment 58 in the name of Alison McInnes. Ready to debate with Amendment 1. Move or not move?
Consequential. Not moved.
The question at Section 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Questions at Section 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Call Amendment 8 in the name of the Minister and a group in its own. Minister, to move and speak to that amendment, please.
Convener, this amendment removes the requirement for a body to be repatriated to Scotland before a fatal accident inquiry may be held in the death of a Scot abroad. The bill as introduced included this requirement for repatriation of the body mainly because that was what Lord Cullen recommended in his review of the FAI legislation, but also because this mirrors the practice in England and Wales. The coroner's duty to investigate a death abroad only arises if the body is returned to the coroner's district and the circumstances are such that an inquest would have been held if the death had occurred in England and Wales. The Solicitor General, when she gave evidence to the committee at stage one, indicated that repatriation of the body may provide crucial evidence of the cause of death. Repatriation obviously opens up the possibility of a post-mortem being held in Scotland, and when a body is repatriated from abroad, it may be accompanied by a death certificate from the foreign authority, which may also provide useful evidence. This may or may not, depending on the standard of the examination carried out abroad, confirm the results of examination of the body. It is accepted, however, that there may be instances where it is simply not possible for the body to be repatriated. The body may not be available because it may have been destroyed in the accident which caused death, or the body may have been lost, possibly at sea. It may also be the case that it is simply not possible to repatriate a body on grounds of cost. Advice from the Foreign and Commonwealth Office is that bereaved families may wish to consider cremation of a body in the country where the death occurred. And this is partly as a result of the significant expense of the repatriation of a body, but it also does mean that a family may have a body cremated before they become aware of the possibility of a death investigation and possible FEI in Scotland. The Scottish Government is liaising with the Foreign and Commonwealth Office with a view to its guidance being updated with these new arrangements coming into operation as smoothly as possible for families. I know that the committee raised the issue of repatriation of bodies as an area of concern very early in its consideration of the bill and has consistently pressed this point, including in the Stage 1 report. I'm very happy that the Scottish Government and indeed the Crown Office have been able to take on board these concerns and are now able to agree that repatriation should not be required. The important discretion afforded to the Lord Advocate in Section 6.3b, C and D will remain in place. This means that the Lord Advocate would have to consider that the circumstances of the death have not been sufficiently established in the course of an investigation in relation to the death, that there is a real prospect that those circumstances would be sufficiently established in an inquiry, and that it is in the public interest that an inquiry be held. We should also be careful of raising unreasonable expectations among the bereaved family that an inquiry would definitely be held and of what an inquiry in Scotland might be able to achieve. The Crown Office will have to rely on the government and legal authorities of the country in which the death occurred, and standards of investigation and cooperation vary across the world. It is expected that it would only be in exceptional circumstances that the Lord Advocate would decide that a death investigation and possible FEI were merited in the absence of repatriation of the body, but it is a very important advance that this possibility should exist, particularly as this is not the case in England and Wales. So I move Amendment 8, Convener.
So repatriation is not required in England. Repatriation of the body is not required in England and Wales. No, it wasn't required by this committee either.
It is required.
It is required in England. So we've done a good deed then here in this committee.
We've gone beyond practice in England and Wales.
Christian, I think in particular in your area, yes.
Yeah, I just want to show my appreciation for the government to have listened to the committee, particularly for a lot of families in the North East of Scotland who have a lot of people working abroad, a lot of them working offshore, and I think they will be all delighted of the news that in exceptional circumstances there will be a possibility to have an FOI without the body being recovered.
It's a kind of common sense amendment. And I take it you don't want to wind up, Minister. No. Question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to, are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Question is that Section 6 be agreed to, are we all agreed?
Agreed.
The question is that Section 7 be agreed to, are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Call Amendment 59 in the name of Patricia Ferguson and a group on its own. Patricia, please to move and speak to that amendment.
Thank you, Convener. A sudden death in a family is a difficult experience, and the sudden death of a family member in circumstances that might require a fatal accident inquiry is likely to be particularly traumatic. We've all heard of incidences when the experience is exacerbated by the time lag between the death and the decision about whether or not an FEI is to be held. And there's often been a feeling that many families have articulated that they have not been comfortable with the way in which information has been communicated to them. My own bill sought to introduce time limits within which that decision should be made and for communication with families affected by that decision. Those ideas, however, did not meet with universal approval. In the meantime, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service had begun to draw up a charter detailing how such communication with bereaved families should take place and also when it would take place. I believe that this charter is an important improvement on the current situation, so I'm content to support the idea of a charter and to table this motion. However, it seemed to me that the provision of such a charter should be underpinned in the legislation, and that while the Lord Advocate should retain the right to revise the document from time to time, he or she must lay the charter and any revisions that might be made before Parliament. I'm very grateful to the Minister for facilitating this amendment, and I hope that the committee will support it, and I move it.
Much, members. Roddy.
Just very briefly, Convener, just to support this amendment to anything that increases our understanding of the families of the system and how it's supposed to operate is to be welcomed.
Yes, I would congratulate Patricia Ferguson on pursuing this, because it's a bewildering process for families. Any court process is bewildering, but an FAI, you're coping with the loss of a close member of family in a process that's in the public interest, and sometimes they feel as if they're on the sidelines to it. So I think it made a very important progress in this. I don't want that to sound patronising, because it's not meant to be. It's just a good point. With members' bills are useful for these things. Minister.
Thank you, Convener. And at stage one, I welcomed the commitment by the Solicitor General to consult on and produce a charter of investigation milestones, which will address concerns over keeping bereaved families informed about the death investigations and complement the provisions in the bill to make the FAI system more efficient. And I certainly want to acknowledge Patricia Ferguson's own role in raising that agenda. I welcome the committee's comment in its own stage one report that the publication of a milestone charter should help address the delays in the FAI process, unquote. Bereaved families must be kept better informed of progress throughout death investigations, and although I do believe that the Crown Office has made great strides in this area in recent years, particularly since the establishment of the Scottish Fatalities Investigation Unit, I believe that this charter will provide a clear and easily understandable guide for families of what to expect from the investigative authorities at the Crown Office at a time of great strain and distress to them. The Charter aims to provide guidance on what the bereaved families should expect from the Crown by way of the provision of information about death investigations and the timescales within which that information will be provided. The Crown Office will communicate with families in the manner which the family prefers. This could be face-to-face meetings, by letter or phone call. It is proposed that in cases requiring further investigation with a view to deciding whether criminal proceedings should be instigated and or whether an FAI should be held, the Crown will make contact with bereaved families 3 months after the date that the death has been reported to Crown Office, Procurator Fiscal Service. They will offer the family a personal meeting within 14 days to give them an update on the progress of the death investigation. They will also give them an idea of the likelihood of criminal proceedings and the possibility of an FAI. It is also proposed that the Charter will explain the different stages of a death investigation and set out the commitments of the Crown Office in terms of keeping in touch with relatives, and it is proposed that they will contact the families every 6 weeks after the initial contact. The Charter will also include a frequently asked questions section and links to further information. And I'm therefore delighted to welcome this proposal by Patricia Ferguson to give the Charter statutory underpinning. The amendment places a duty on the Lord Advocate to prepare and publish the Charter and specifies what should be included in the Charter, though it will be subject to occasional review, and the Charter must be laid before the Scottish Parliament. I would like to take this opportunity again to thank Patricia Ferguson for all of her work on FEIs and for agreeing to discuss areas of potential common ground as recommended by the committee in its own report. We've had an open and constructive discussion on areas where there was common ground for collaboration to improve the FEI system by strengthening the Scottish Government's bill, and this amendment is one of two which we have agreed with Patricia Ferguson. The Government is happy to support this amendment by Patricia Ferguson, and I would ask the committee to do the same.
Patricia, to wind up, please.
Happy to leave it there, Convener.
So you're pressing it.
I'm pressing.
Okay. Questions, Amendment 59, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 7 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, ready debate Amendment 1. Margaret, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Are we agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. It's 5-4-4 against. That amendment is therefore agreed to.
Am I going slowly enough for you?
Yes. Been told to slow down. The question is that Section 8 be agreed to. Question is that Section 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 9 in the name of the Minister Group with Amendment 55. Minister, please, to move that amendment and speak to the other amendment in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 9 is a technical drafting amendment which is intended to bring a reference in Section 10, which relates to those persons who are entitled to participate at a fatal accident inquiry, into line with that in Section 2.3 for reasons of consistency and clarity. The provision in Section 10 ensures that the employer of someone who is killed in the course of their employment is entitled to participate at the mandatory FEI, as was the case under the existing Fatal Accidents and Sudden Deaths Inquiry Scotland Act 1976. Elaine Murray's Amendment 55 would give a statutory right of participation in a fatal accident inquiry to a trade union or staff association representative if the deceased was a member of that trade union or staff association at the time of death and they died in Scotland as a result of an accident in the course of their employment or occupation. This committee, in its Stage 1 report, stated, and I quote, "We believe it is imperative that families, trade unions and staff associations are able to participate in a meaningful way in an FEI and that families are represented appropriately and are kept informed throughout the process," unquote. The Scottish Government agrees with this statement. As the convener noted on the 12th of May, the bill provides in Section 10, Subsection 1E, that any other person who the Sheriff is satisfied has an interest in the inquiry may participate in the inquiry proceedings in relation to the death of a person. The Scottish Government considers that Subsection 1E would permit the Sheriff to allow a trade union or staff association representative to participate in an accident at work fatal accident inquiry if he or she thought it appropriate. Nonetheless, in light of the committee's Stage 1 report, the Government is content to support Amendment 55 in principle, subject to exploring with Dr Murray whether any adjustments to the wording should be made at Stage 3 to ensure it gives full effect to the policy intention. I move Amendment 9 in my name.
I think that's a semi-victory where we're coming up. Elaine, please, to speak to Amendment 55 and the other amendment in the group.
The Minister for making most of my case for me. I think there's quite a thing. So I was going to say I don't actually require to say. No, I'm certainly
It's not mandatory. You
I'm content
opt out.
To have a look at the wording. It was a little bit difficult to try to get it to make sure it's a member of a trade union up who's relevant to the occupation, not you might have another job and be a trade union member with in some other employment, or indeed that has to be at the time of their death rather than some previous occupation or membership and so on. So it's maybe slightly clumsy in the way in which it is written, but I'm pleased that the Minister is accepting it, because I think it is important that trade union representatives and staff association representatives have a right to be there, not only because they may have information which could be of assistance, but very importantly because they could be of significant support to the victims' families as well.
I feel a tweak coming on. Tweaks are very fashionable. Anyone else wanting to come in? Minister, do you wish to wind up?
I'm happy to leave it at that, Kavita.
Question is, Amendment 9 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 55, the name of Lane Murray, already debated Amendment 9, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is Amendment 55 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 10 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 60 in the name of Patricia Ferguson, in a group on its own. Patricia, please, to move and speak to Amendment 60.
Thank you once again, Convener. As the committee is aware, this bill has its genesis in the review of fatal accident inquiries undertaken by Lord Cullen at the request of the Scottish Government. One of the recommendations that he made that has not found its way into the bill so far is around the availability of legal aid. My own bill sought to explore this particular area, but did, I would recognise, go considerably further than Lord Cullen suggested. Lord Cullen, in my view, made two particularly important points in relation to legal aid. The first is that relatives often believe that the Procurator Fiscal attends an FEI to look after their interests, particularly if they are unrepresented. The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service own guidance makes it clear that this is not the case, and also indicates that the role of the Procurator Fiscal is to represent to the court any matter affecting the public interest. The second point Lord Cullen made was that FEIs take place whether or not relatives consent to it. Now, if relatives want to participate, their ability to do so without representation is obviously limited, and they can be at considerable disadvantage compared to other interested parties. Indeed, the Faculty of Advocates stated in evidence to Lord Cullen that, and I quote, "it is impossible for relatives to participate effectively in important inquiries without legal representation." While Sheriff J.P. Murphy observed that the relatives, quotes, "should not be expected to be capable of self-representation in the traumatic situation of an FEI. I have never seen a layperson do it adequately." So the amendment in my name seeks to disapply the normal tests around reasonableness and to disapply also the normal financial conditions and thresholds, and requires ministers to come forward with a special scheme of conditions for relatives involved in FEIs. Now, Convener, I've deliberately not been prescriptive about what those regulations should be, but have instead left to ministers the job of making that particular decision. But I do so in the context of a presumption that legal aid will be available and that families will be able to be represented throughout the process, which has been an issue, and will not find that cash runs out partway through an FEI. It seems to me that this is a basic principle and one that I hope that the committee will support, and I move.
Thank you very much. Other members, please. I'll take Margaret, then I'll take Roddy.
I support this. What Patricia Ferguson has said has backed up the evidence, I think, that the committee heard when we looked at this point in particular. As things stand, as she quite rightly says, the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service represent the public interests, and the interests of relatives are not represented. I think it's only right and fair that legal aid is available to ensure that these interests are represented. So very much in favour of this.
Thank you, Convener. I'd be interested to see what the Minister has to say on this point. Just, obviously, I accept that Lord Cullen did report in these terms in 2009. From looking at our evidence session with Lord Cullen, I don't actually think the committee actually quizzed him further on whether that would have remained his view in the circumstances in which we now are. But obviously, I think, I know comments have been made about resources implications, but in particular on this one, I think we should have regard to what the resources implications are of this. So I'll be interested to hear from the Minister on that.
Yes, I'm in a similar position to Rory. I'm sympathetic to the arguments. I don't think I'm going to support it at this stage, but I'd like to hear at stage three further reasons if this fails, it might not, but whether the government acts against it, you know, because there is an issue. In FEIs, very different from criminal proceedings, but it is an issue in FEIs about the deceased family and relatives not having even, in certain circumstances, not having any legal support of any kind. But I would have concerns about a special case being made. But I do note the bit, you know, with no financial test, I would have concerns about that. But I do note the bit about that you have in your amendment, must be able to make provision for financial conditions. So I'd like to see that develop. So while I'm not at this stage going to support, I think I'd like further inquiry and investigation by the government into whether they might, you know, there might be something in regulations subject to tests and financial tests of a certain kind, perhaps, whereby there is support for relatives, because I do think there's an issue here. It's a very new grey area, FEIs. While it's in the public interest, there are families sitting there who are bereaved, and for whom it will open it all up again in circumstances, as I say previously, where we've moved with the communications that the Crown has to make into involving people in the process more so they get some support. And that might be in form of just explaining the legal process to them. So there isn't, I think, an issue I'd like the government to explore further. But I'm not at this stage, but I would like it considered. Minister.
Thank you, Convener. I note the comments you've just made. I am aware that a number of groups are supportive of Lord Cullen's recommendation to remove the reasonableness test and that financial eligibility should be increased where relatives are seeking civil legal aid for FEI proceedings. This is what Amendment 60 clearly aims to achieve. Relatives are obviously in a terrible situation, and I fully acknowledge that when they experience a death of a family member. It is important that they should be able to participate appropriately in an FEI where there is one. But this does not automatically require legal representation in every case. The purpose of a fatal accident inquiry is to investigate the circumstances of death in the public interest in order to try and avoid any future incident of the same kind. The Procurator Fiscal leads evidence to establish the cause of death. Procurators Fiscal thus have a public duty to fulfil at the inquiry. They will meet with the family to discuss what witnesses and evidence they intend to produce at the inquiry and what questions they intend to ask. Often the Fiscal will ask the family if there are any particular questions that they wish to be answered. But it can happen sometimes that the families have questions which the Fiscal does not feel that it would be appropriate for them to ask, since they are representing the public interest. It may be that the families wish to ask questions which may be intended to establish whether there are grounds for civil proceedings following the fatal accident inquiry. And in such cases, they may consider that they require their own legal representative to do so. If the family cannot afford to pay for such legal representation, they may be eligible to receive legal aid. The Scottish Legal Aid Board can make legal aid available where a person is entitled to be represented at a fatal accident inquiry can show that they have concerns which the procurator fiscal is not going to raise at the inquiry. And hopefully the charter process will improve the openness of what the procurator fiscal is going to do, and that will help inform the family's actions at this point. The reasonableness test will therefore be satisfied if they can show that they have legitimate concerns and questions which the procurator fiscal cannot ask in the public interest. The effect of the amendment would be that legal aid would become available more or less on demand for fatal accident inquiries. Now, I note the point that the convener has made, and I understand that point fully and sympathise with much of what was said. Many FAIs will result in purely formal findings from the sheriff based on the evidence led by the procurator fiscal. It is difficult to see the case for a guarantee of legal representation in all such cases. If legal representation became universal, the likelihood is that FAIs will become more adversarial, longer and potentially more costly. And I understand, or certainly understood, that this was one of the key points that Patricia Ferguson wished to avoid. In the current financial climate, and I appreciate the points that were made early on in response to another point, but I have the lack of luxury here. I have to make these points, unfortunately, convener. In the current financial climate, during which the Scottish Government's budget has remained broadly unchanged in cash terms, controlling legal aid expenditure is necessary. Statutory tests of probable cause and reasonableness apply to any application for civil legal aid, although anyone who is eligible for legal aid will be granted it. And this government has prioritised maintaining the wide scope of matters for which legal aid is available in order to protect access to justice. Removing the reasonableness test for relatives in FAI cases would have a price tag. Legal aid expenditure on these cases varies widely from year to year, of course, but we could expect an additional cost of at least £0.5 million per year. And while I appreciate the earlier comments about not wishing to reduce things to discussions about resources, they do have a significant bearing on the government's position, and that money would have to come from somewhere. In England and Wales, where there have been serious and swingeing cuts to civil legal aid to save money, people there can no longer access legal aid to help with certain types of family, medical, housing and welfare benefits problems. In certain cases, people have to provide evidence that they or their children have been victims of domestic abuse or violence in order to get access to legal aid. I do not want to go down this route in Scotland. I want to put that on record. As I've already explained, if a family has concerns which the Procurator Fiscal cannot address in the public interest, and as I again stress the point that the Charter will help improve transparency around this and the engagement with the family, the likelihood is that the reasonableness test for legal aid will be satisfied. Where a death has occurred in prison, it will also be likely that reasonableness will be satisfied. So legal aid will be focused on the cases which deserve it, so that access to justice can be maintained. I believe that the extension of the entitlement to legal aid at fatal accident inquiries proposed in this amendment is not only unaffordable, it is also unnecessary, and a balance has to be struck. And I regret saying that, because I appreciate the points that were made earlier on about resources, but as I hope the committee can appreciate, we're not in an easy position on this. Therefore, while I have some sympathy, a great deal of sympathy in many respects, with the intention to make legal aid eligibility more certain, I unfortunately cannot support this amendment.
Patricia, please, to wind up.
Thank you, Convener. Firstly, I'd say in response to Mr Campbell that I'm not aware that Lord Cullen has repudiated his view, and I would have thought if he'd changed his mind he would have said so when he gave evidence to the committee. But I would also point out that, in my view, this is a matter of principle and really shouldn't focus at all upon the amount of money that it might cost. But I will come back to that in a second. But taking that point of principle, relatives are also capable of being pragmatic. And I would point to the example I know best, which wasn't a fatal accident inquiry, but in some ways was very similar, which was the Stockline inquiry, where there were 10 bereaved families, but only 3 representatives, because 8 of the families came together and agreed that they would have one single representative for all of the people in that particular group, with 2 families deciding that wasn't the way they wanted to go. So families can be pragmatic. Now, with regard to the current role, or the role of the Procurator Fiscals, the guidance that has come to Procurator Fiscals indicates that, and I quote, and this is the guidance they give to families, that it is unlikely that he or she will be able to adequately represent their interests and concerns at their inquiry, and that separate representation is considered appropriate. Now, that's the guidance families are being given by the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service, convener. So it seems to me to be very strange that we make those suggestions to them, or the state does, and at the end of the day, we don't provide them with a methodology that allows them to actually access that representation. But I've deliberately said that Scottish ministers should come forward with a financial contribution scheme. I haven't left it as an open-ended blank cheque. I have left it open for the minister to work out a formula that would be acceptable. And I would just point out that the current situation, as matters currently stand, the Scottish Legal Aid Board automatically treat the condition of reasonableness as met without question in the case of deaths in prison, for example. So it seems to me that this is a provision that really, in the interests of fairness and the interests of justice, more importantly, has to be taken forward. And I very much hope the committee will see fit to support it.
I take your pressing. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. And an abstention. So that's 5-4, 3 against, and an abstention. That amendment is agreed to. Questions at section 11 to 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call amendment 10 in the name of the minister. Grouped amendments 11, 19, 20, 22, and 23. Minister, please, to move amendment 10 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Convener, Amendment 10 is a technical amendment which simply clarifies what information the Procurator Fiscal must provide to the Sheriff when giving the Sheriff notice that a fatal accident inquiry is to be held. The Fiscal must, under Section 14.1, provide the Sheriff with notice that the inquiry is to be held, a brief account of the circumstances of the death, so as far as is known, of course, to the Fiscal, and any other information required by an act of sederunt made under the Bill. The existing Section 14, subsection 2, requires the Sheriff to make an order fixing the date and a place of a preliminary hearing, if one is to be held, and the date and place of the inquiry itself. At present, it only makes reference to the Sheriff doing so on receipt of notice that the inquiry is to be held under subsection 1A. It does not make reference to the requirements of subsections 1B and C, and the question arises as to what the Sheriff should do if he or she does not receive this information. Amendment 10 removes this uncertainty by making it clear that the Sheriff should receive all of the material set out in subsection 1. If the Sheriff does not receive that material, then he or she will not be required to order the inquiry. Amendment 11 is a consequential on Amendment 10. Amendments 20 and 22 are concerned with what material the Procurator Fiscal must provide to the Sheriff if further inquiry proceedings are to be held under Section 28 of the Bill, in the light of the new evidence in relation to the circumstances of the death. Amendment 22 requires the Fiscal to provide the Sheriff with a copy of the determination from the original inquiry into the death or deaths, as well as notice that further proceedings are to be held. Amendment 20 requires the notice of the further inquiry proceedings to include the material mentioned in Section 30, subsection 1C and D. Amendments 19 and 23 are consequential. I move Amendment 10 in my name.
Any members wishing to speak? No, I take it you don't wish to wind up, Minister.
I'm
questions,
fine.
Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay. I call Amendment 11 in the name of the Minister, ready to be with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally. Questions, Amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Questions at Section 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Questions at Sections 15 to 25 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 12 in the name of the Minister, group with Amendments 13 and 14. Minister, please, to move Amendment 12 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. This group of amendments are technical amendments to Section 26, under which the Sheriff can redact or withhold all or part of their determination from publication. Amendment 12 amends Section 26, subsection 2, which sets out the government bodies that should be given a copy of the determination and related documents on request. The intention is to put devolved non-ministerial departments in the same position as UK departments. The amendment therefore changes the Scottish ministers to, I quote, an office holder in the Scottish administration, unquote. The Scottish administration includes the Scottish government, so there is no longer a need for separate reference to the Scottish ministers. The Scottish Housing Regulator and Food Standards Scotland are within the Scottish administration as well. The purpose of this amendment is also to ensure that future devolved departments, such as a Scottish Health and Safety Department, are covered in this provision, so I commend this amendment to the committee. Amendment 13 removes the reference in Section 26, Subsection 5, to Sheriff having to look to provision made in an act of sederunt made under the Bill when considering redacting sensitive or other material in a determination at the conclusion of a fatal accident inquiry. The Lord President has recently issued guidance on redaction of judicial decisions generally, including FEI determinations, and the amendment is consistent with the principle that redaction is a matter for judicial discretion and guidance. Sheriffs will therefore continue to use their discretion in relation to redacting determinations guided by the framework provided by the Lord President. Amendment 14 ensures that the Lord Advocate and participants in the inquiry will receive full unredacted copies of the Sheriff's determination at the conclusion of an inquiry. The reason for drawing a distinction in terms of different recipients is that the persons who may receive an unredacted copies of determinations are either participants in the inquiry or public authorities, including governments and the Health and Safety Executive. By contrast, the Sheriff will be able to exercise discretion using the guidance from the Lord President when sending to a person to whom a recommendation has been addressed to ensure that their copy contains all of the material relevant to them, whilst omitting sensitive material that they do not need to see, for example, affecting children or issues of national security. I move Amendment 12.
Jenny Rush to speak. Margaret.
The clarification, Minister, on the purpose of the amendment also being to ensure future devolved departments such as health and safety are covered in this provision. Is this how these kind of issues are normally dealt with before, in advance of any possibility of it happening?
Well, it certainly, in this case, it just provides the ability that any future devolved departments, such as the Scottish Health and Safety Department, are covered in this provision. It's to avoid unnecessarily having to come back to amend the legislation. So it's purely a practical measure. There's no particular agenda underlying it, if that's the concern of Margaret Mitchell. So it's really just to allow some flexibility and avoid the need to come back and amend legislation at a future date.
I was just trying to clarify if at present they're dealt with as and when the eventuality arises.
I believe that is normal, but I also think this is a practical measure to avoid having to come back to amend legislation retrospectively.
I
don't have any suspicious agenda here, that's all I can stress.
I take it that was your winding up, Minister, was it?
Indeed, I'm
okay.
Happy.
Questions that Amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Are you agreed, Margaret? Me as well. There you are. That's a semi-victory. Amendment 13 in the name of the Minister. Ready be Amendment 12. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Questions Amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 14 in the name of the Minister. Ready debate Amendment 12. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Questions Amendment 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The questions at Section 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 15 in the name of the Minister. Group with Amendments 16, 17, 31 and 32. Minister, please to move Amendment 15 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. This group of amendments is intended to clarify how the process of dealing with responses to Sheriff recommendations will be dealt with by the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. Convener, in its Stage 1 report, the committee welcomed the proposals in the Bill to require Sheriff's determinations to be published and to require parties involved in the inquiry to whom a recommendation is addressed to respond to the recommendations. The committee considered that this struck the correct balance in seeking compliance with recommendations. The Scottish Government believes that these proposals will have the effect of ensuring that Sheriff's recommendations are respected and that the whole process becomes more transparent. There may, however, sometimes be good, justified reasons why part or all of a response should not be published. Amendment 15 makes it clear that it will be possible for the whole of a response to a Sheriff's recommendation to be withheld from publication and not just part. It is expected that requests for the withholding of all of the responses will be very rare, but a party may have good reasons for doing so, such as commercial confidentiality or the protection of vulnerable persons. Amendment 17 will ensure that the SCTS website will make it very clear whether all or part of a response has been published. If part has been withheld, then a note will explain that fact, and if, unusually, the whole of a response has been withheld, an appropriate note will signify that fact. Under the new subsection 7, notice will be given if no response is received. While SCTS may withhold part of a response for data protection or other reasons without a request being made to that effect, they will only withhold all of a response if a request to that effect is received. The final decision will, of course, always be with Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, who have experience of redacting judicial opinions under formal guidance issued by the Lord President. The experience of the equivalent procedure in England and Wales is that responses have been received in 100% of cases, and there have thus far been no representations for part or all of a response to be withheld. Parties seem anxious to demonstrate compliance with any recommendation directed towards them. And there is no reason to suppose that the response rates and reaction in Scotland will be any different to that experienced in England and Wales. The Crown Office have previously indicated that there is no evidence that parties fail to implement sheriff's recommendations, and in many cases remedial action has already been taken by the time an FAI is actually held. So I move Amendment 15.
Else wish to come in? No, that's it. I take it over to wind up, Minister. Questions Amendment 15 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 16, the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 15. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Questions Amendment 16 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? Yes. Call Amendment 17, the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 15. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Questions Amendment 17 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? Yes. Call Amendment 18, the name of the Minister and a group in its own. Minister, please, to move and speak to that amendment.
Thank you, Convener. It's an essential aspect of the Scottish Government's policy that fatal accident inquiries should remain inquisitorial and not adversarial in nature. By endorsing the general principles of the Bill, the Justice Committee has endorsed this particular principle. Section 6, subsection 3 of the Fatal Accidents and Sudden Deaths Inquiry Scotland Act 1976 protects the inquisitorial principle by providing that the determination of the sheriff is not admissible in evidence and cannot be founded on in any future judicial proceedings of whatever nature arising out of the death or out of any accident from which the death resulted. That provision is reenacted in Section 25, subsection 6 of the Bill. The rationale for this is that the sheriff should not be inhibited from explicitly or implicitly criticising a party who was involved in the death, since the function of the determination is to record the result of the examination of all of the circumstances of the death and to permit the sheriff to make recommendations as to how deaths in similar circumstances may be avoided in future. Equally, however, it is reiterated that the FAI process is not designed to be a foundation for subsequent civil litigation. The Bill contains express provision for the sheriffs to make recommendations in their determinations at the conclusion of FEIs, a new requirement for participants to whom recommendations are addressed to respond, and a statutory regime for the collation and publication of responses to recommendations. An interested person will in future be able to find on the SETS website both the sheriff's determination and responses to the recommendations made. The question then arises as to the admissibility status of the recommendations themselves. The Scottish Government is concerned that if a recipient of recommendations were to engage with recommendations directed to them in good faith and offer a full and open response, explicitly or implicitly accepting criticism, then pursuer's agents might seek to found on the response as the basis for civil action. This could have the effect of inhibiting recipients of responses from responding fully or openly at all, and they may feel, having taken legal or communications advice, that a note on the SCTS website stating that they have not responded is preferable to and lesser risk, perhaps, than a response which could invite civil proceedings or at least hamper prospects of a defence. Responses to the sheriff's recommendations should therefore be inadmissible in other judicial proceedings, and we strongly believe that this will help to foster a culture of respondents making a virtue of having constructively addressed sheriff's recommendations, and I move Amendment 18 in my name.
Wish to? No, I have no indication. Take it, don't want to wind up. Minister, questions Amendment 18 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? Questions at Section 27 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 61, the name of Patricia Ferguson and a group on its own. Patricia, please to move and speak to that amendment.
Thank you again, Convener. Amendment 61 requires that a report is prepared annually by ministers of recommendations made by sheriffs in relation to FAIs. The report would contain information regarding the number of recommendations made, the number requiring a response, and the number of responses received. The amendment also requires such a report to be laid before Parliament. As you know, my own bill went further than is now being proposed, but I'm conscious that my preferred way of working might have resulted in such recommendations becoming the subject of appeals designed to delay the introduction of a recommendation, which clearly was not my intention. It is to be hoped that this alternative will reinforce the importance of such recommendations by making them the subject of such a report, and that that importance is emphasised by ensuring that they are laid before Parliament and published. And I'm very grateful to the Minister and his team again for their cooperation in making this particular element of the section possible, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to comment? No, except well done again, I think, Ms Ferguson. There's hope for us all on the back benches. Minister?
I am aware of concerns expressed by the committee and others about ensuring that recommendations made by sheriffs at the conclusion of fatal accident inquiries are respected. And again, I want to thank Patricia Ferguson for working on this so hard. The view of the Crown Office and the Health and Safety Executive is, however, that where sheriffs do make recommendations as to how deaths and circumstances similar to those of the death, which is the subject of the inquiry, can be prevented, they are passed on to the relevant parties, and regulatory and other authorities are taken very seriously. They have commented that remedial action has often been taken by the time an FEI is actually held. That should not, however, be taken as a reason for complacency. The bill now formally obliges Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service to give a copy of a determination to each person to whom a recommendation is addressed and to any other person who the sheriff considers has an interest in a recommendation. And this would obviously include any regulatory or government body at Scottish or UK level. In the committee's stage one report on the bill, the committee stated they welcomed the proposal in the bill to require sheriff's determination to be published and to require parties involved in the inquiry to which a recommendation is addressed to respond to those recommendations. Pointed out that considered that the proposal struck the correct balance between improving compliance with the recommendations and noted the view of witnesses that there could be difficulties in placing a duty on a particular body to monitor the implementation of sheriff's recommendations and consider the proposals in the bill to be sufficient. I believe that the proposals in the bill for requiring responses to sheriff's recommendations will foster compliance, based on the evidence I outlined in England and Wales, where there has been a high degree of compliance. But publication of the response or notice that no response was received will make the system more transparent. It mirrors the procedure used under the system of coroner's inquests in the South. As I have said, however, we should not be complacent in this regard. And this amendment, in the name of Patricia Ferguson, places a duty on the Scottish ministers to publish an annual report of responses to recommendations made in sheriff's determinations to be laid before Parliament. The report will indicate the number of such responses received alongside the number of inquiries and the number of recommendations requiring response made during a reporting year. It will also indicate the number of failures to respond. The Ministry of Justice, as I say, reports there has been a 100% response rate for the similar rules in effect for coroner's inquests in England and Wales. So there's no reason to believe that a similar rate of response would not be achieved under FEI legislation in Scotland. Persons to whom recommendations are addressed are usually only too anxious to demonstrate their compliance, and recommendations are only made in one-third of FEI determinations, an average of 20 per year. And so reporting the number of responses and non-responses should not be onerous or expensive indeed. And having a record of non-responses in an annual report will allow trends to be identified over time by interested bodies. So I agree with the principle of Patricia Ferguson's proposal. I would again like to thank Patricia Ferguson for her work in this area, and I hope the committee will support this amendment.
Patricia, to wind up, please.
Happy to leave that.
And you're pressing it.
I am.
The question is that Amendment 61 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 19, the name of the Minister, already debated. Amendment 10, Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
The question is that Amendment 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 20, the name of the Minister, already debated. Amendment 10, Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
The question is Amendment 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 21 in the name of the Minister, group with Amendments 24 to 30. Minister, please to move Amendment 21 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. This group of amendments is intended to clarify the procedure for reopened and fresh fatal accident inquiries when there is a need for further proceedings following new evidence in relation to the circumstances of a death. Lord Cullen recommended in his review that it should be possible for further inquiry proceedings to be instigated if new evidence came to light, which would, in the opinion of the Lord Advocate, mean that a finding or recommendation from the original inquiry would have been materially different. Lord Cullen did, however, express the view that it would be rare for new evidence to render so much of the original determination unsafe that a completely fresh inquiry would be necessary. The Scottish Government agrees that it will be rare for a new inquiry to be necessary, and if the new evidence is brought forward, which may be rare in itself, then the norm will be that the original inquiry will be reopened and continued. I would like to clarify that these provisions are not meant to assist parties who are dissatisfied with the handling or outcome of the original FEI. The appropriate remedy in such a case would be a judicial review, were there any legal flaw in decision making. Amendment 21 requires the Lord Advocate's opinion on whether the form of further proceedings should be a reopened or fresh inquiry to be included on the notice to the Sheriff under Section 30, Subsection 1, that further inquiry proceedings are to be held. It is entirely appropriate that the view of the Lord Advocate should be known to the Sheriff, who is to take the final decision on whether an inquiry is to be reopened or a fresh inquiry held. It is also appropriate that the Lord Advocate should express such a view, since he or she has taken the original decision that the new evidence merits further judicial consideration. Amendment 24 requires that the sheriff to hold a hearing when a notice is given under Section 30, Subsection 1, that further inquiry proceedings are to be held. This hearing will allow the Sheriff to hear representations of the Procurator Fiscal and the participants in the inquiry in order to permit the Sheriff to reach an informed decision about the form that the inquiry is to take. The purpose of this amendment is to meet the rationale behind Lord Cullen's recommendation to allow further proceedings. In his review, Lord Cullen said, and I quote, "It should be for the Sheriff to whom the application is presented, after hearing the Procurator Fiscal and the interested parties, to decide which form of proceedings is appropriate in the particular case," end quote. Lord Cullen did go on to say, however, that he favoured in general having reopened inquiries, since a rehearing of the whole evidence may be unnecessary, though he did concede that there may be cases where a fresh inquiry is necessary. Amendment 26 will oblige the Sheriff to consider whether there is a public interest in a fresh inquiry being held rather than reopening the original inquiry. This will be assessed on the basis of the circumstances of the particular case. There are clearly potentially substantial resource and cost issues to holding an entirely fresh inquiry, and it is right that the Sheriff should have regard to the public interest in deciding whether the original inquiry should be continued or a new inquiry be held. Amendment 25 is a drafting amendment which provides consistency in the provisions of the Bill, and Amendments 27 to 30 are consequential on Amendment 24. I move Amendment 21 in my name.
Wish to? No. And you take it, you don't want to wind up. Minister, the question is that Amendment 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendments 22, 23, 24, 25 and 26, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move these amendments en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 22 to 26? If the question is that Amendments 22 to 26 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? Question is that Section 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 27, the name of the Minister, already debated on Amendment 24. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Question is that Amendment 27 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 28, the name of the Minister, already debated on Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Question is Amendment 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Question is that Section 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 29, the name of the Minister, already debated on Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally. Question is that Amendment 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Question is that Section 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendments 30, 31 and 32, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. Invite you, Minister, to move these en bloc.
Formally moved, en bloc.
Does any member object to a single question put in Amendments 30 to 32? The question is that Amendments 30 to 32 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? Question is that Section 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Questions at Section 34, Schedule 1, and Sections 35 to 37 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 33 in the name of the Minister. Group with Amendments 34 to 51. Minister, please, to move Amendment 33 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. For reasons which I'll explain in a moment, I do not wish to move Amendment 33.
I think you have to move it.
And then okay. We decide whether or
right,
not we're happy that you can withdraw.
I will proceed as planned then, Convener.
I think that's correct. I can do it either way. I think I'll just make you a bit uncomfortable and get you to move it first.
Okay, I'm at your leisure. Convener, the Fatal Accidents and Sudden Deaths Inquiry Scotland Act 1976 is nearly 40 years old and has served Scotland well. It follows that there are a number of cross-references to the 1976 Act spread across the Scottish Statute Book, for example, in the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman's Act 2002. This grouping of amendments is technical and comprises purely consequential amendments to existing legislation to replace references to the 1976 Act with references to the Bill. Schedule 2 to the Bill would be expanded from 3 paragraphs of consequential modifications to more than 10 such paragraphs. Amendments 37, 40, 41, 47 and 48 repeal redundant provisions which themselves had amended the 1976 Act. Were related amendments required to be made to UK extent statutes in the law of England and Wales and Northern Ireland, these will be taken forward in the order under Section 104 of the Scotland Act 1998. I do not move Amendment 33, if it's okay with the convener, which would repeal Section 30. which would reveal Section 38 of the Administration of Justice Scotland Act 1933. After further researches by the Bill team, it transpires that this redundant section has already been repealed and there is therefore no need for Amendment 33. I move Amendment 34, Convener.
You're moving. We're not at that yet. So I'm just going to go through this again.
Okay.
So you're not moving Amendment 33, right?
Indeed.
Which we're all quite happy about, I take it. The repeal repeals. What? Just bear with me a second. There's a new contract. Right. Because I was made you move it,
okay,
you've got to seek to withdraw it.
May I seek to withdraw Amendment
33? Well, I think we're all feeling charming today about it, and we say yes. So that's it gone. Right?
Thank
Amendment
you.
33 gone. So I call Amendments 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50 and 51, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. And now, Minister, I ask you to move Amendments 34 to 51 en bloc.
Moved en bloc for me. Yeah.
Does any member object to a single question being put on these amendments? I think it's time for coffee. The question is, Amendments 34 to 51 are agreed. Are we all agreed? We're coming to the end. I'm glad to know that the finishing post is in sight. The question is that Schedule 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Mm-hmm. Question is that Sections 38 to 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Mm-hmm. That ends Stage 2 consideration of the bill. And can I thank the Minister and his officials? Can I say to the committee, an amended reprint of the bill will be published overnight. I know you'll be glad about that, so you can get busy with any Stage 3 amendments to be lodged with the legislation team. And I'm going to give us a 7-minute break, Minister, because you're back again. Yes, I need seven. Thank you very much. begin. Thank you. Item three, it's an evidence session in relation to the Community Justice Scotland Bill. And last week, we requested a written response from the Minister on how two related policy developments might interact with measures in the bill. These are the Scottish Government's current consultation on whether the presumption against short periods of imprisonment should be extended, or whether a more radical review of the use of short-term imprisonment is required, and the final decision to be taken on the future configuration of women's prisons arising from the Question of Women Offenders 2012 report. And I thank you, Minister, for providing a response at short notice. And I know you're here to answer questions on this response. So this is an evidence session. And I welcome the Scottish Government officials, Andy Bruce, Deputy Director, Community Justice Division, Arlene Stuart, Head of Community Justice Operational Unit, and Carolyn O'Malley, Legal Directorate for Legal Services. And members, questions straight into it. Any questions? I think they're battered into submission in the last session. Alison, stir your stumps. Let's have you going.
Thank you very much, Convener. As the Convener said, I think we're particularly interested in the interplay between the Community Justice Bill provisions and two other major pieces of possible reform, one round about the women's prison estate and the other about the possibility, much welcomed by myself at least, of extending a presumption against short-term sentences. But really, I think the committee is seeking some assurance that the Community Justice Bill isn't running ahead of itself if these other reforms are happening. Is it fit for purpose to bring about the kind of radical change that is also proposed with these other things?
Well, I believe it is. If it would be helpful to Convener, I'll just set out some reasons why I believe that's the case, and hopefully that will reassure Alison McInnes and others.
Just reiterating your response, we've got that.
No, it's just, I think, obviously we've set out before, I'll not go over again, the vision for fair justice in Scotland, but that vision reflects the values of a modern progressive nation, I think one that we obviously hope to, I think all around this table want to achieve, and where there's a stronger emphasis on robust community sentences focused on actively addressing the underlying causes of offending behaviour. So the bill does provide the legislative basis for the new model for community justice in Scotland. Establishing a new body, Community Justice Scotland, it places specific duties on statutory partners and introduces a national strategy and performance framework for community justice in Scotland. The new national framework for outcomes, performance improvement will enable, we believe, the consistent evaluation of progress in delivering community justice outcomes. But specifically, the new model has been designed to be sufficiently flexible to respond to new policy developments and opportunities at both a local and national level. And I'm confident, for example, should the use of community sentences increase in the future, perhaps as a result of the consultation on presumption against short sentences or other measures, then the new model could support that. We have, as I've said before, a consistently high imprisonment rate. The government is determined to change that by reducing use of custody. And clearly, we do have a desire to reduce, in particular, the use of short-term prison sentences that are largely ineffective and do not seek to and do not achieve a reduction in reoffending. So we are of the view that the presumption against short sentences of 3 months or less has had a limited impact so far, and that's why the consultation has been taken forward on proposals to extend the presumption. But I suppose the essential message is on that front that we believe that the model that has been developed is sufficiently flexible, Convener, that it can be adjusted to take account of any policy direction that we go down in this regard, and that obviously if there are resource implications, they would be reflected on. But the structure is sufficient to cope with that is the key issue. Do you want to talk about the women's prison estate at this moment in time, Convener, in response to Alison McInnes?
I think what we were looking at is when we look at your response, and I think if you add the figures together, 29%, 37% for the 0 to 3 months and 3 months to 6 months, that's 66%, 6 months or less is an awful lot. Is the money going, I think the point we're making is the money going to follow people if you go down this route, which I think many of us would welcome, is the money going to follow into community justice if you're saving money in the prison service? Because you say here, in paragraph page 3 of your letter, that shift is already being seen with resources transferred from the SPS to invest in community-based services. Well, you know, what much is that? Well, that's really the question, is yep. It's already well, but is the money going to follow the change?
I will maybe bring in Andy Bruce on this point, but initially if I would just say that clearly, you know, any implications of any subsequent decision that we take on with regard to extending the presumption against short sentences would look quite closely at the resource implications. But the key thing is that the bill itself will deliver the structures that will apply in both scenarios. Whether we do extend the presumption against short sentences or do not, the structures can be the
same. I understand, but
the resource implications I appreciate. And
but you have a precedent here, and I think that's what we maybe want to know about, if that shifts. Already seen resources move.
Yeah, I appreciate that point. I'll maybe, if I may, Convener, with your consent, bring in Andy Bruce on this particular point.
Yeah, I think the paragraph you referred to, Convener, specifically refers to the money that's transferred from SBS to community for the women's based services.
Okay.
So this was the 1.5 million that the Scottish Government had originally invested and that we've now made sustainable as a result of a permanent transfer from SBS to community. But I think that's a statement of intent. I think, as the Minister said, almost implicit in these developments is a view that we want to see that shift from custody to community. It's clearly we're about to enter a spending review period, and it makes it difficult to be very explicit at this stage about it, but I think we can absolutely recognise the principles that yourself and the rest of the committee are saying around that shift in resource to support the wider vision.
Alison, do you want to...
I mean, that wider provision that we need, thank you, Convener, of consistent and effective community justice services, you know, will need to be developed quite significantly. Can you elaborate a bit more on how Community Justice Scotland would ensure that there was that proper provision?
Well, one thing to point out in the diagram that was attached as an annex to my letter to the committee, Convener, was set out that obviously the range of bodies that are involved in diagram one with delivery of community justice, but also highlighted that the relationship between Community Justice Scotland and the Justice Board itself, and indeed between the Justice Board and ministers. So we want to put non-custodial solutions on the same parity of esteem with custodial solutions. And I think having Community Justice Scotland represented on the Justice Board, where such matters are routinely discussed in terms of the balance of resourcing and the implications of policy as it develops for other functions of the justice system, is a good forum for ensuring that any resource implications are addressed and ministers are informed thoroughly of the steps that are needing to be taken to ensure that adequate resources is provided to deliver on the policy intention here. So I hope that general diagram clarifies the structures and the relationships between the different bodies involved in delivery of community justice under the model that's envisaged, but clearly also states quite transparently that Community Justice Scotland will have a role in the Justice Board where such matters are already discussed, and indeed discussions have been taken forward about the women's custodial estate in that context already, and this provides a balancing in terms of looking at the issues and implications for community sentencing options and the resourcing of those in the appropriate forum, and to allow a good engagement on the issues that arise.
One of the drivers for these changes was that I think the Audit Committee said that there was a very cluttered landscape here. I mean, I think there's a real risk of it being even further cluttered. We've had some supplementary written evidence from the convener of the Community Justice Authority, basically saying we remain very concerned that issues around authority, responsibility, accountability and leadership remain unresolved. And they raise concerns about us talking quite, and your Minister talking about the potential for improvement, the opportunity for change, and then the hope that better outcomes will follow. Do you not think that we need to be more direct than that, that we need to have more clear assurances on that?
I can accept those points that Alison McInnes raises. I know her genuine interest in trying to ensure that the quality of services that's delivered is enhanced, if possible, rather than just maintained. So I take them in the spirit they're meant. In Annex B, the diagram 2 to the letter tries to make clear in setting that out how there would be an improvement process in place. So I'm not a huge fan of management diagrams and things, but I think in this case it does help. The triangle on the right of the diagram makes clear the process where targeted support and improvement activities would be provided by Community Justice Scotland to local agencies involved at delivering community justice in each of the 32 areas. Recommendations might arise to ministers and indeed assurance to local government leaders as well. But as we kind of go up through that triangle, that pyramid, potentially the involvement of multi-agency inspection, which is not a small measure, which would obviously look in greater detail at any perceived failings in delivery of community justice at local level, ultimately potentially leading to a rescue task force being task group being deployed to ensure that the
potential escalation action means
indeed that there would be some teeth to Community Justice Scotland, I suppose, is the way of putting it. That yes, I genuinely believe there are opportunities, and we do hope that there will be improvements, but we do also have behind us in the proposed model the opportunity for multi-agency inspection and indeed potentially a rescue task group to be deployed to ensure that the standard of services at a local level is brought up to the appropriate standard. And I think that is an important point Alison McInnes raises, and I hope that clarifies that this is not a woolly process. It's something that does have some teeth to it, but we all want to work in partnership with the local partners where we can, and that's why it's important not to jump in with the tackety boots at the start, but to try and work with the local partners to deliver targeted and support and improvement to help them deliver good services at a local level if they can do so. But ultimately, if they're not able to do so, then we can obviously intervene in a more appropriate way.
Thank you. I think that's very helpful.
Can you just remind me, Minister, where this business of rescue task force and beefing up, possibly, I understand about tackety boots, but having tackety boots at the sign, ready if you need them, where does this, how will this, isn't part of the primary legislation, where is this going to be?
Well, this is obviously through the process of secondary legislation. We would propose to deploy this, and obviously Parliament will have the opportunity to consider the detail of that in due course, Convener. I guess we were trying to address a concern that there was among members that perhaps at this stage, where we're really dealing with enabling powers, that we're not providing sufficient detail about our intent, and hopefully this clarifies
correct.
What we would intend to
go. I
think
that's right. Roderick, followed by Margaret, followed by John, please.
Good morning, Minister.
Morning.
Could you just clarify for me, if you can, to what extent the National Strategy and Performance Framework will be a kind of living document which will kind of reflect changes in penal policy, or is it going to be kind of something a bit more stuck in and not flexible, put it that way?
Clearly, the strategy is going to be a hugely important document that will, I hope, in line with other measures, to provide this kind of parity of esteem for non-custodial sentences and community-based solutions, that a strategy with some buy-in and power from stakeholders as well it needs to be developed. And National Strategy and Performance Framework, indeed, which I think we discussed at previous session, there are some draft outcomes which are being looked at in terms of how they can be deployed at local level and being piloted, so that there's that is under development at this moment in time in terms of informing the performance framework that would be published. That these will be documents that will be published as soon as practicable after the bill has been passed. So I can't, at this moment in time, I hasten to stress, try and subvert that process and come up with suggestions as to exactly what will be in the strategy. But the strategy will clearly be an important document that will be provide clarity about what the government is trying to do and indeed stakeholders together are trying to do to deliver robust and effective community sentences to reduce reoffending. I don't know whether that's quite what the member is looking for, though.
Kind of flexible to cope with kind of changes which may come in relation to short sentences.
Well, indeed, it wouldn't be a static document that would sit on a shelf, I hope, forever and not be reflective of changes in policy as we go forward. It can be reviewed and obviously brought up to date and kept up to date with best practice as well as we develop our knowledge of best practice going forward. If it may help, Convener, to help Mr. Campbell, if I could, with your consent, bring Arlene Stuart in this point, because I know it's something that Arlene has been looking at.
So in terms of the national strategy and what we've been doing, we've formed a steering group which has representatives from different partners and stakeholders who would have an interest in this. So Social Work Scotland, the Third Sector, SPS, Police Scotland and others. And they're doing exactly that. They're steering the development of the national strategy at present. Now the bill allows for the national strategy to be developed and it has to be published within a year of the bill being enacted. However, it also allows for the strategy to be refreshed to allow for exactly that, changes in policy, changes in context, and so on. Now, Community Justice Scotland would have a role in effectively monitoring the efficacy of the strategy. Is the strategy still fit for purpose? And they'd be able to make recommendations to ministers as and when required to do so. But back to the development, we've come up with a broad range of themes. There's lots of different working groups looking at this, as you can imagine, with the development of any national strategy. Some of those are around communities, because this is obviously a community-based model, so it's about empowering communities. There's another one around ensuring the effective interventions, which goes back to some of the earlier discussion we've had already this morning. And taking it forward, we've started the first of four regional events to really engage with people on the ground about what they need to be in this national strategy to make a difference. So we had the first one in Aberdeen last week. We've got the next one, which is coming up this week in Glasgow, and then we go on to Dumfries and finally in Edinburgh. So it's really important that those people who will have to be making reference to this strategy when they produce their plans have the most input to this in developing the national strategy going forward. There will then, with a strategy, be the implementation plan, which will be coming forward, and then working through that as well.
Thank you, Minister, for the diagram. I think that's helpful, even if it does kind of present more questions. When the bill was first mooted, when we had the informal briefing, it was very much stated that Justice Scotland and the local partnerships, community justice, local authority ones, would be a partnership. But it does appear from the diagram, the new model for community justice, that community planning partnership, the Scotland Community Justice Scotland, from some things also in your letter, they would be very much taking the lead. Well, we wanted somebody to take the lead, but also ensuring compliance. And we're looking at national strategy, the detail of which we don't know at present. So in many ways, I think what we're being asked to do is look and just see how it works, which perhaps isn't ideal. Could you comment particularly on some of the concerns raised, that there didn't seem to be any emphasis on the preventative measures, the early intervention, and particularly the third sector involvement, who more than just being consulted on, maybe should form more of a partner in delivering some of these services and objectives?
Well, certainly, if I can reiterate points I think I have made before, but just to put them on the record, in case I haven't done so formally in Parliament, that we do recognise the very important role of the third sector, not just in terms of engagement and consultation, but because they're key delivery partners in delivering community justice. About a third of the activity I think I have put on record before is delivered through the third sector, so clearly they have a hugely important role to play. I do take the point that Margaret Mitchell makes about the different view you can take about the balance between centre and local partners, depending on which version of evidence we're looking at. Just to reiterate, we very much see this as being, and indeed touched upon in relation to the response I gave to Alison McInnes, we do see the necessity to have the ability to step in and sort out problems if they are presented, and they can't be resolved by local partners. But we do want to work with local partners to support them to deliver change if that's required, based on perhaps in the fullness of time, delivery against outcomes under the performance framework isn't to an acceptable standard, then we do have to take steps to make sure that that is addressed. Starting to do that initially in partnership with the local partners and providing the support and resources they need to be able to bring it up to the appropriate standard. But if that isn't possible thereafter, that is where perhaps there's more of an interventionist role for Community Justice Scotland. But that would be informed by dialogue with the local partners as well, of course. But I do think it's important to stress that we are trying to empower local partners as much as we can within the framework we have set out, so that there is flexibility. We've not been directive as to who should be a lead body, partly because we believe all parties at local level should have responsibility for delivering the outcomes, but it does allow also the flexibility in the drafting of the bill for local local partners to determine themselves as to how they work together, how they perhaps work across the local authority boundaries as well with neighbouring authorities, and there is flexibility in terms of commissioning as well, depending on the desired approach that needs to be taken. So we've got a mixture of structures which provide some solidity but also some flexibility in the system as well, and that's important to try and maintain a degree of local accountability but also local flexibility to suit circumstances as well. So I appreciate the diagrams are never perfect. It's never easy to come up with one that summarises the position neatly, but I wouldn't want to imply that the relationship is one that is in any way kind of directed from above. But we do have to have the ability to step in and support where necessary, and indeed, if need be, if there are failings in terms of outcomes delivery, to be able to put in place either a multi-agency inspection or a rescue task group if that's necessary. So I think we're striking the right balance between local and national, and providing some degree of certainty to the point that Alison McInnes is making, providing some teeth if that's necessary, but also only deploying that when it's absolutely necessary rather than at the very beginning.
In terms of striking that balance, if the penal reform goes ahead and the presumption against a sentence of not just 3 months now but 6 months comes into force, clearly these community justice partners are going to have quite a substantial increase in workload. So are you confident they're still going to have the flexibility and resources to prioritise locally and to look at the prevention and early intervention, which we all agreed was pretty germane to the whole proposal?
Well, I haven't seen stage one report yet, but I think there were a sentiment that we were looking at early intervention focused in this bill.
Yes, I mean, I think we can obviously say more about this in due course, but in terms of the preventative agenda, I know this is a point that Mr. Finney raised as well, and when I gave evidence originally on the stage one process, about the definition of community justice and what's in that. Just to stress that, I mean, there are a range of preventative strategies that the government already has in place which complement what we're doing in community justice. So, as I think I said at the previous committee session, there are frameworks in place for early years. There's a draft national improvement framework for Scottish Education, GRIFIC, as well, and Children Young People Scotland Act are all dealing with the primary prevention at the earliest stage to try and prevent people committing crimes in the first place and giving them the support they need to have an equal chance in life across society. We have, I suppose, a grouping of strategies which maybe come under secondary prevention as well, which community sentences, Community Justice Scotland bill, this bill fit in within, and there's a whole range of other strategies which I will not go through in course, but it's the point to be made that this is dealing with reducing reoffending. There are existing strategies which support the targeting of reducing offending in the first place and supporting young people in particular to get the best start in life and to have the reduced chance of committing an offence. But we are looking, as we go forward in the bill, about the definition of community justice and trying to reflect the sentiment of the committee and wider stakeholders and reflecting prevention. But I just want to put that on record there. This is not to be seen in isolation. Community Justice Bill sits alongside a number of very well-prepared and highly regarded strategies which deliver preventative measures at an earlier stage, perhaps in someone's life. And this is about trying to reduce the risk that someone will reoffend once they have offended in the first place. But we do take on board the point about prevention, and we'll try and do what we can to reflect that in due course.
I think probably when I was thinking of early intervention, it was narrowing it down more to, because that's very broad. I mean, that's very broad. Early intervention starts in the pram, but it was more like diversions from prosecution, not
yes.
putting people into the system in the first place, so it then kicks in. So it's probably narrowing it down to that.
I accept that diversion from prosecution
yeah.
can be very helpful, indeed, in the context of the Offensive Behaviour Act. Of course, that's something that we are taking forward ourselves to try and reduce the need to criminalise uh-huh. someone in the first
yes.
place.
John.
Thank you, Minister, for your response to the letter. I'd like to firstly say I think there will be tensions, national, local, strategy agencies, the third sector, and positively dealt with. I don't think they should create a difficulty for us. You allude to something in your response there, Minister, which is about the proposals for strengthening the presumption against what ineffective short sentences and for female offenders, and that is the transfer of resources in the Scottish Police Prison Service, quote, to invest in community-based services and work by the SPS to transform its role. this is with the reference to the through care and the integration of people back into the community. I'm trying to understand what, there's an example surely we can learn about as on an ongoing basis about the transfer of resources from the institution to the community. Are you able to explain, because your work there and the SPS to transform its role, maybe its role doesn't extend. I mean, I'm personally supportive of the community, but should it not be a facilitator rather than necessarily a deliverer? What the relationships would be with the third sector, who might see that as their traditional ground, and where among all that would Community Justice Scotland sit?
Well, clearly, I accept the point that Mr. Finney has made that we shouldn't be prescriptive, perhaps, about the role of SPS in this respect. But I think what we're seeing already in a number of fronts, and I've seen evidence of this myself, that the SPS are trying to do what they can to get more engaged in perhaps ensuring appropriate employment for those with persons with conviction when they leave the prison system, to try and reduce their reoffending that way. So they're being much more proactive perhaps in education, ensuring working with partners outside the prison service to ensure there's appropriate housing for people when they come out. And these are all important measures. So I suppose I would maybe flip it around and say we wouldn't want to be in a situation where we cut SPS loose from that very important work, but they're increasingly getting involved in, and I think very positively, to try and help provide as much certainty for those who unfortunately have to spend time in the Scottish prison estate, that they have got a viable future ahead of them, and one that they will be supported to resume a normalised way of life and reduce the risk of reoffending. So I think that is, I guess, my balance. But I take the point that if there are opportunities that don't involve SPS, then that's okay too. And third sector might be a more appropriate partner to work with in those situations. So I don't think we should be prescriptive, and I do take the point that Mr. Finney raises. But I suppose we're trying to reflect in this that SPS are trying to become much more proactive themselves in supporting re-engagement in society of those who are coming through the prison system, and making sure they have the support they need to reduce their risk of reoffending. I don't know whether Andy Bruce perhaps would want to comment further, if that may be helpful to Mr. Finney on some examples.
Yeah, I mean, perhaps just expand on that through care support officer role. I mean, perhaps the way to look at it is we absolutely see that transition from custody to community really, really important, and people making that transition would really benefit from someone alongside them to provide advocacy support as they make that return to the community. And I think the role of the TSO can be sat alongside the role of the mentors that we've supported through the PSPs, which are primarily third sector. And the way to perhaps look at it is you'd want to make sure that for that person you're providing the best support for them. So if, for example, they've developed a really, really good relationship with their prison officer, there's no reason for the end of the prison sentence to be the end of that, if that suits them. But equally, if actually the last thing they want is to continue that relationship because of that experience, then there should be a mixed economy, I guess, available for them to provide that support. And in that situation, it's probably more appropriate that they look to a mentor from the third sector. So the approach that we're trying to support is, well, looking at the particular needs of that person leaving prison and what would be the best support package we can put alongside them. And it should be third sector support if that's best for them. But equally, if actually it makes sense for continued support from a prison officer, then the system should be able to support that as well.
How does that actually work in a balance sheet then? Because someone is going to hold that resource. I mean, I'm reassured greatly by what you say, that it's an individual tailored support. But where's the funding for that coming? You know, if Jimmy or Mary want the prison officer or don't want the prison officer, presumably there's resources there that the prison officer could do it, or is that a resource? Is that going to be something that's going to be dealt with, for instance, by Community Justice Scotland? Would they be expressing a view?
Well, I think, obviously, we're trying to look at how we can formally reflect the role of third sector in the bill itself, so just to reiterate that point. And I do think there's an extremely important kind of delivery relationship between all the kind of statutory partners on the third sector in that respect. I do think that as the funding, we've obviously got the transitional period that we'll be looking at as well, where there's going to be sort of ongoing kind of examination of the resourcing that is required. We're obviously working on some assumptions at the moment, and we've undertaken that we'll reflect on any kind of particular pressures that arise in that process. But in the longer term, I do accept that we need to think about how we work with the third sector, the commissioning arrangements. Obviously, we've outlined where we're trying to give more clarity and more stability to the third sector partners as well. That's a slightly separate issue, I appreciate, from the one that Mr. Finney's making. But also within that, we can look at how funding mechanisms work in terms of if there's a person-centred approach, then we have to be able to reflect that in terms of how we resource that activity. And that's something we can maybe come back to the committee with some further information, further thinking on that, if that would be helpful.
Not batting for any particular side.
No, I appreciate that.
I think it's whatever appropriate. But it won't be as simple as reduced admissions to prison means that there'll still need to be a certain cohort of prison staff, regardless of the number that's within.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, for health and safety reasons and a whole raft of other.
But can you just remind us, because I can't remember, what's the cost of somebody per annum in prison just now?
It's very significant. I know it varies. I have a figure in my head, which is probably incorrect, so I probably should revert to Andy Bruce just in case it's...
I appreciate what you say about the staffing levels, but there's...
Yeah, so I mean, if the point that you're raising is that by not having someone in custody, you release resource, then that is absolutely...
Yeah, but do we have an
correct
idea, kind of ballpark figure for it?
Yeah, the figure that he's coming at somewhere around 32, 34K.
It can still be that. That was what it was 10 yeah. years ago when I was getting that quoted, surely.
Yeah, I don't have an up-to-date figure.
It's very helpful to know that from the public's point of view, you know. But I mean, I certainly know we're quoting that a way back, and I don't think it'll be static.
Yeah. I had a slightly higher figure in my head, but I'm glad I didn't use it.
What was the slightly higher figure in your head, Minister?
I thought it might be nearer the 40,000, but that may be incorrect. But
tend to agree.
But we can try come back to the committee with a more accurate figure.
Other than that, you've been very economical in the prison service, and everything else in life is costing more, including salaries.
And obviously, I suppose one of the variables we should recognise, as I think Mr. Finney acknowledged, that there's a fixed number of staff, fixed prison estate. So as the number of offenders in custody actually drops, particularly, and we've had great success in delivery in our youth justice approach, that we've got fewer offenders in Polmont, for example, that the cost per prisoner actually increases. So it's to be fair to Mr. Bruce, it's a bit of a movable feast. But we can obviously try and see if we can provide a more accurate figure.
But there are savings to be made, obviously.
It's acknowledged. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Christian, followed by Margaret.
Yes, on that particular point of mixed economy that Andy Bruce talked about, and we talked a lot about the third sector, but I didn't see anything on your reply about the private sector and how much the private sector is doing to help. So can you maybe give us some ideas on this and make it a bit more clear? But it's a mixed economy, and there are other parts, not only SPS and the third sector, but there are other parts as well.
I apologise if that's a failing in the response, given I know this is an issue that Mr. Allard has raised a couple of times before, and a very important one. We are doing...
I asked you about that in our letter this evening, Mr. Allard.
Well, yes. I'm happy to address it, Convener, if I can, briefly, and just to give some reassurance to Mr. Allard. We are doing work on trying to look at how we change the environment in terms of private sector employment of people with who have convictions, and be aware of the proposed changes in terms of the disclosure of spent convictions as well, in terms of trying to make it easier for individuals to, where it's not relevant to the job they're going for, don't necessarily declare an old conviction that they have experienced. But we have some very good proactive employers, both across the UK and within Scotland, that are working with the authorities in Scotland and Scottish Prison Service to try and provide employment opportunities for individuals who leave the prison estate and make sure they have a viable employment option. So it's not just about housing, it's not just about other issues I discussed earlier. Employment is obviously one of the, probably the most, apart from housing, important way in which we can prevent people from reoffending. If they've got a stable job and a home to live in, there's a very good chance that they will not reoffend. So I take that point on board, and we can try and address that in subsequent debate.
Just thinking the devil finds work for idle hands, and we're reminding us of that. But not that you've got idle hands, Margaret, so what's your questions? Thank you.
Well, you might not be saying that after I've asked my question, because I wanted to ask you about victims, actually, and I know that wasn't part of the letter that we had sent you. But, you know, community justice is essentially about the communities and, obviously, justice for all, which includes victims. And, you know, if we didn't have the offenders, there would be no victims. So there is very little mention of victims in this bill. And I just thank you very much for the flowchart. That is very useful. But I just wonder where the victims are represented within this whole bill, because from my point of view, there doesn't seem to be any representation at all.
Well, I certainly, you know, certainly respect the point that, that Margaret McDougall has made, and I know of Margaret's sort of strong interest in this area and indeed experience.
It's not a person. I'm trying to be.
No, no, but I you know, I appreciate the point, and it is important. It's a point of address, I think, in not in the parliamentary debate so far, but external to Parliament, regrettably, in terms of these questions were raised. And what we are looking at is an opportunity, I think, at local level, the 32 areas, for engagement with representatives of victims and indeed wider communities as to the kinds of community sentences that perhaps might be most appropriate, so that if we can have community sentences that not only help in reducing reoffending but also deliver some collateral benefit to the local community in the process, so they're maybe targeted at a particular need. Something that might be seen as being helpful to the community, and there are opportunities to do that, I think, in the structures. Rather be prescriptive about what form they should take, that kind of engagement can happen at a local level, and they may form examples of good practice that could be then taken forward, publicised and rolled out through the efforts of Community Justice Scotland as well. So working with local groups, whether it's representatives such as, you know, Scottish Women's Aid and other third sector organisations that work on behalf of those who survived an abusive relationship, to sort of look at what kind of things would help at local level, through to engagement with community councils and other community groups as to what kind of things would constitute community sentences that might provide reassurance to the community that they are meaningful and that they are not only helpful in providing a robust alternative to custody, but they also deliver something which is perceived to be of benefit to the community, then that would be good. But we can try and reflect further on how we represent the interests of victims and how we take forward the bill, and I take that point.
Thank you.
In full.
Well, thank you very much. That concludes this evidence session. Can I thank you very much, Minister, for making yourself available today, pretty well single-handed to us. And we're now moving into private session, so I wait for the public area to be cleared. Thank you.
Thank you.
And you have a kind of like 2-minute wee break to get your coffee.